Hello and welcome to Berks Business. I'm Bob Wirt, Managing Director for Investments of the Wirt Investment Consulting Group of Wells Fargo Advisors. Each month on Berks Business, we give you the opportunity to meet the leaders of our local business community and ask questions during our live program on Monday night. You can give us a call at 610-378-0426 during our live program. Our guest tonight is Marshall Pickard. Marshall, welcome to the program.
Thank you, Bob.
Marshall runs a company called Pickard Advertising and Design. Tell us about your company.
My company, I'm a sole operator and owner of a graphic design firm and advertising and marketing firm. I specialize in anything in print media, from logo design, brochure design, your basic ads, flyers, pretty much anything anybody needs printed, I can design for them. I also do some web work along with email blasts and electronic media.
So you've been doing this for how long?
Close to 20 years in total, this business as a freelance and as my own firm for about 15.
When you think about how somebody gets prepared for a career like what you have, what do you study? Where do you go to learn this sort of thing?
You need a well-rounded background, to be honest. Most students start out in an art program in high school, have an interest in art, build a portfolio, and go to a graphic design schools such as the University of Delaware, Kutztown, there's RIT. I actually went to Temple to more of an advertising and marketing program. Didn't go on as heavily as the design, but I supplemented that through art programs. But the key thing is, if you are going to go into advertising, you don't want to go into fine art per se. You more want to go into one that has a graphic design program that will end up going towards the actual field itself and preparing you to work in an ad agency and like businesses.
So how do you pick up the business knowledge along the way? Because those are two remarkably divergent skill sets, from being able to design the work to being able to get somebody to actually want to buy it.
Well, I guess some of it's like anybody else. You learn through your own mistakes. There's actually a lot of good organizations. One is the Graphics Artists Guild that puts out a yearly book that basically is the Bible on how to run your business, how to deal with things such as non-compete clauses, how to deal with, you know, proposing bids to clients, how to even charge, you know, what are the going rates around the country, or how to negotiate business and to realize, you know, is a job, you know, every client, usually you bill based on what their billings and their sales are, and you know, small businesses can't afford to pay what an IBM can.
Right.
So sometimes you do look at it and say, okay, is it worth working for this client who needs this but can only pay B? And you basically, as any other businessman, you got to decide the positives and the negatives of that.
So what jobs are worthwhile taking versus what are not? What are you thinking about?
Well, if it's a client, one, I like working with clients that one I know or like. I like working with startup businesses personally because I like seeing people being able to get their business and grow. Mm-hmm. For example, we're later going to look at a logo for Down Under Sports Fitness that I did, and they sell it on shirts now. They've gotten a lot of positive feedback from it, and I was happy to be able, you know, they were opening their gym and right, they needed somebody to be able to do their logo at a reasonable price but still get a professional job. So there's a type of clients because they really actually appreciate the work afterwards too.
That helps a lot.
Yes,
it does.
It
helps you build the word about too for your business.
Yes, it does.
Super. Yeah, talking about how the nature of technology has evolved, you have a basic educational background in graphic design, and you also have a teaching background.
Yes.
How do you translate that, I mean, into a field that is, I mean, email blast didn't exist 10 years ago, and all the things that you can do these days?
I think it's always wanting to have a desire to learn, having a desire to want to be creative, to think outside the box, willing to be able to take risk. Mm-hmm. I've always had a wide background of interest. I read a lot. I was also an English major. I have an MA in English. And you'd be surprised. I used to work at Lennox Collectibles. Just even my background in English and other things, I could pull into that because I knew the history of certain products. And you just, a lot of it is you have to be willing to evolve. You have to be willing to keep with trends, and you've got to be willing to learn. You got to learn how to do new things. I haven't gotten deeply into website building because it's a skill set that I realize I don't have the time to learn, but I also have connections that I can hire out for that.
Right.
But I have learned to do email blasts and other things because it's something actually that I found out was very simple, and it plays right into my graphic design background.
Right. Gets the message out very quickly and very inexpensively.
Yes, exactly.
That works. Let's talk about when you're trying to build a brand identity, how do you do that? How do you identify? You start with a company, a client comes into you and says, I want to work with you, and I don't know what I don't know yet what my brand identity is going to be. How do you help them?
Oh, normally when they're looking for their brand identity, the first thing they want is they'd say, I want a logo, something I can put on my letterhead, on my business. And the key component there is the interview, is talking to the client. First finding out, what is it you do? You know, what is your business? And I've done some stuff. I've worked for companies that they're security firms, but they deal with data, which to me, I completely had to research it to understand what I was talking about. And there is a tower company that actually builds the cell phone towers. That's what they do. You've got to listen to them and really dig deep and talk to them and say, what is it you do? Then you got to find out, well, what's unique about your business compared to other businesses? And some of them have a very distinct view of how they want to be seen. Again, going back down to Down Under, the owner, Sam, is from Australia. The co-owner, he's American. So they wanted to tie in a kangaroo in Australia and build that into the business. So they did have an idea of what they wanted.
Right.
But, you know, if you ignore them, you're not going to end up getting it. And a lot of times, too, you also, if somebody's in a field, such as we were talking earlier about financial, you're going to research other financial firms, find out what they do, what does your client do different, what sets them apart, and then really build upon that.
That makes sense. We have a page of logos, so I'll ask for that up in a moment. And so you can kind of get an idea. We can talk a little bit about what went into each one of those to make it interesting or to that the client had. Let's see if we have that ready. It's got about six logos on it. Well, actually, instead of that, let's do this piece.
We can talk about this piece. This is a piece that I did for a company called Petco. Petco is a company that sells online pet food and pet supplies and toys, things of that nature.
Right.
This piece, actually, there was two mailings. We talked about how do you sometimes find out a response if you do a brochure or mailing. This company was actually very good. The owner believes in testing, and testing is a very key. We did two very distinct personalized pieces that offered the billing a different way. One was more elaborate and cost more to do than the second piece, and basically, we tracked how many coupons came in. We had coupon codes on everything, and we were able to track the sales. And if the one that did the most sales was the piece that we went forward with after that.
Now, the piece that we're looking at the moment is personalized. How did that happen?
You can actually now, working with printers, that you give them your mailing list, and they inkjet the names on right onto it. You've probably seen it on your bills, anything else, and you know, that's where you can say, welcome, it says John Q. Sample. Well, that would have been, welcome, Bob Wirt. And it would have looked like it was just done for you. And it's really, you're dealing with larger mailings when you're dealing with this, but it's an inexpensive way to personalize a piece and add a little extra to a mailing.
So when you, before we get into the logos piece, let me let's stay back on the one we were at and just think about, so you approach a campaign like that, what do you ask the client? What do you say to them? Or what do they say to you?
Well, that client actually very much knew what he wanted.
Okay.
He knew how he wanted to offer coupons. He wanted to test the percent off on the coupons. He wanted a traditional direct mail kit that had a letter, a brochure. Originally we were talking about gluing on almost like a card, like a credit card that they would use for their 10% off.
Right.
Well, to save costs, we came up with, you know, we could do a die-cut perf that would just pop out, went that way. And then, again, it was asking about the company. It's like, who do you sell to? Who are your clients?
Right.
Who is buying this? Who is ordering off the internet? What kind of images do you want associated with your product? Yeah. Since they had a very distinct, I mean, it was animals, but he also wanted, he said, you know, I want not just dogs, I want cats, I want birds, I want certain specific animals in the photographs.
Right. Well, some animals are probably a lot more popular than others. So you want to
Yes.
Sell
those owners.
But he has, for example, they sell a lot of bird seed, too, to people who have parrots. So he did not want that just excluded.
And that's predominantly a web-based business?
Yes.
Okay, let's now we had that logos page, so we'll come back to that and talk about how each of those companies arrived at their logos.
Well, the top one was to the left, the G, Genesis Tower Service, we were talking about earlier. Was basically, you know, me talking to them, finding out what they were doing, and then just, I kept playing around with ideas. I wanted to incorporate a tower into it, but I wanted to do something that's a little more cutting edge and didn't just look like your traditional logo.
Right.
And they were happy with the down under again was they wanted to incorporate, you know, a kangaroo lifting or boxing along with Australia and American flags. So I did the shield in the background that's red, white, and blue, along with the stars line up for the same stars that you find on Australian flag. The one that said Zubu, it's actually a company still going through a transition period, but they sell bamboo shirts and were looking to possibly change their name, and they said, we want to be a little more fun, we want to be a little more edgy. And this one actually took a long time to get there. It was one that I personally just wasn't getting the look they wanted. So we kept going and playing, and just, I don't know if I just looked at something and it just clicked. I don't remember. There's sometimes just those aha moments.
Right.
You know, sometimes I will just ask my wife, random people for feedback, and it works.
So that conveys more of an earthy and a green and a fun sort of image as opposed to tower services, which looks more structured and
correct.
Solid.
Yes. The Ubu was meant to look more organic. Mm-hmm. And exactly. The one to the right of that, the paperwork's originally is an original design, but a lot of times I'll get clients who want me to finish a job that was started, say their business cards, letterhead, they didn't like how the original design was. And I basically said to them, I said, your logo, I said, you know, I'm not going to change it, but I'm going to update it and make it better, you know, for print, because the earth with the leaf on there was really poorly done and wasn't very usable. And it was basically somebody got some line art from somewhere and just slapped it next to some words.
Right.
So they kept their image, but I, you know, upgraded for it. And then the one below that, Missing Link Security, again, that was somewhat client driven as they were into security. He had always had the name Missing Link, and he wanted an ape somehow incorporated in there.
And that portrays strength at the same time?
Strength, stability, you know, you're not going to be able to break through our firewalls, that
right.
sort of thing.
And the last one?
That's a record retention company. And just basically wanted to do something where if we didn't have the name next to it, that you would get more of a conveyance of what it was, and just the LRR with the paper floating and the color red worked perfectly for the client.
So this looks like the polar opposite of clip art.
Yes.
How does that happen? I mean, you look at a lot of people, I'm sure, come to you and say, well, it'd be cheap if I just did this, but...
But it's your company's image. You know, you wouldn't walk into a board meeting with $1 million client in Hawaiian shorts and a T-shirt.
Maybe not.
You know, unless the client was, yes, you know, somebody who dressed that way. But if it was, you know, the board of Merrill Lynch, you're not going to walk in that way. Anytime you put your name, your company identity on something, that is saying something about you. And the cleaner it is, the more professional it is, the better you look as a company.
Exactly. All right, let's take a moment and take a break now for a little more information about BCTV.
You're watching Berks Business on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. To read other stories concerning local businesses, go to www.bctv.org.
Okay, and we're back. Let's talk about now. So what goes into a good logo, like things like high resolution versus not?
Well, what goes into a good logo, again, is knowing your client, knowing what they want, knowing how it's going to be used. Mm. I mean, and nowadays, that's extremely important because not only do you have print media, you have web media, you have, it's everywhere. And when you talk about high resolution, most clients just glazes over. They think they can pull something off the internet, which is a JPEG and a small resolution file, and print it. Well, it's like taking a copy of a copy for the 100th time and trying to put it out there. It's not going to look good.
Right.
The problem with using clip art, like you said before, is a lot of people use it. It's cheap, and when your logo looks like clip art, people are going to start noticing, why does his logo look like their logo?
Right, exactly.
And you're not going to differentiate yourself from your competition.
You see that in restaurants a lot.
Yes.
So high resolution, I mean, you have to take something that can be scaled up for a large, perhaps, poster, or down
yes.
to a small, or
yes,
using the internet.
Yes. Any most illustrators and designers work in a program called Illustrator, which creates EPS art, which is high res and can be used at any size, any definition.
So what makes an ideal client? What's a good fit for someone like you?
That's a tough question. A good fit for me is someone, like I said before, is enthusiastic about the project, gives me the proper amount of information, has a good idea of what they want to do and what to spend. They're willing to put the proper amount of money into their marketing budget to do it right. A lot of times a client will want to say, build me a website, but they don't really understand if they need the website. They really don't understand what goes into a website. And they say, well, I can go on and get it for $250 from this other, from some online company that it's
right.
going to look like a template. And I will have to tell them, no, that's not what it costs to get it professionally done and get it customized and, for you. And that's, I would say, what helps with the ideal client.
So how do you measure results?
It depends on what you're doing. If it's brand recognition, if it's just something where you are getting your name out there, It may take a year or two to measure it, but if you start getting more and more referrals, I always tell people to track where, say you're in a flower shop and you sell, you obviously sell flowers. Say, how did you hear about me?
Right.
And start tracking. Oh, I saw your billboard. If that was what you were doing at the time. Also, you have to understand what your rate of response is going to be. People often complain about things like the Clipper magazine. Well, I only got one coupon. Well, wait a minute, do you understand that it was 0.1% return is actually a good rate return response? But can you build off of that one coupon? Can you get referrals from that? And that's what you have to understand. And sometimes, just like you said, if you just put the coupon out there once and you put all your budget into that, that's poor marketing.
Right.
If you can plan to run it six times, then it starts to get, it takes about 6 to 7 impressions of any sort of advertising before it clicks in the customer's mind.
Oh, absolutely. So how do you decide which mix of media to use? How much money do you want to spend, say, on internet? How much do you want to spend on direct mail versus billboards versus whatever?
Well, one, you look at the client and what they do. You look at what best suits them. A lot of people believe, yes, I need a web presence. Well, maybe you don't. Maybe that's not, if your budget is only $1,500, maybe it's not best in your first year to put all your money into the web.
Right.
Maybe it's social media. Maybe it's just Facebook. Maybe it's, if you're a landscape company, handing out flyers might just be best. Or you might say, I'm going to put half into postcards that I'm going to send out, but I'm going to reserve half to give some sort of gift to the people who refer new business to me.
Right.
You really just got to think creatively, especially small business. When you have a tight budget, you must be creative with it.
So when you have a tight budget, for example, we had a period where sales were down for a lot of folks. Is that the best time to start advertising or stop advertising?
That is when you need to advertise. That is, a lot of people pull back their marketing.
Right.
And I know of businesses that doubled their marketing departments while business was down. Yes, it was tough for them, but you know what? When that service is needed, they're the name that's been out front for the past year, and people will start turning to you.
So it makes the business seem more stable and more reliable if they're out there in a
yeah, more stable,
time.
More reliable, and also it's again, it's name recognition. You can look at any sort of business. You can look at, doctors. Well, who's the first person that comes to your mind when somebody says, Natalie Parisi, who owns Reading Orthodontic Group. I don't do any work for her, but I think she's a marketing genius. Her name is everywhere. She is out there, and she does it inexpensively, and she does it in interesting ways. And she's constantly doing it, so she's constantly in the public's mind. So when your kid needs braces, she's the first person people think of.
And it's consistency when you go into her office versus they have the stickers on people's cars.
Correct.
And then there's the contest that goes with it that makes people want to do that.
Correct.
Plus,
yes.
When you get there, there's that feeling that they know who you are.
Exactly.
So it makes a
big
difference.
She does follows through on everything with that.
Super. Let's talk about some of the other programs that you've done. We had a brochure back there for Lennox we'll talk about in just a moment, in which it opens up and it gives the viewer one impression on the outside, and you open it up and it gets into more about the product.
Yes.
So if we can see that, that'll be, there we go.
Yes, this is tabletop product. It was Mickey Mouse through the years, little sculptures of showing in different periods. I had to design the front cover, and the idea was to show the nostalgia of Mickey Mouse. That it's a feel piece. It's you're selling on people's emotions. This is going directly to customers that are. We had a list of people who are interested in Disney memorabilia and also Mickey Mouse.
So then that kind of cover gives them the invitation to come in and see what's inside.
Yes. And you want them to open the brochure.
So, and that's not an easy thing to do anymore, especially if you get your mail today and there's 10 different brochures in it. How does yours get opened?
Well, hopefully, if on a piece like that, you hope you've got to know your target audience.
Right.
I mean, you're not going to send Mickey Mouse to somebody that's into Spider-Man.
Right.
It's just not going to work. So right there, it's going to end up in the trash. And you have to know, those emotional key points that is going to tie the whole product and sell it. And it's not just the brochure. There's sales letters that are involved, the envelope. The envelope is your first indicator of to invite the person in.
Exactly. Changing gears a little bit, you also did a brochure for St. Philip's, which is a school.
Yes.
And, you could use just here's a 8.5 by 11 letter going out to somebody, or you can use your brochure. Why would somebody use the brochure? Let's talk a little bit about that.
Because it's an image piece. It's an image that portrays what the school is about. Why in Maryland would you send your child to this elementary school versus another?
Right.
Obviously the information in there is going to tell you all the great points about it, but you also want to visually show that we are a great school, that we are very well organized, we are very, clean, that, the kids are having fun, they're learning. You want it. It's all about image. It's about, and any other piece they should do after this would fall in the same site of format, colors, and look.
So it shows that they're working. It shows that they're in uniforms. This sort of thing. That
the things
the
that
the school.
Yes, of what the school, how the school wants to sell itself.
Okay. You also did posters. So we'll talk. I mean, posters completely different rendering than
correct.
Everything else that you have done. Let's take a look at one of the posters and we'll get an idea of what went into making that successful.
Well, the key to a poster is you want it to stand out. You want it to convey your message quickly. There's one from the IMA World Challenge for Chris Keg. And he is the face of his charity, of his organization. But the key to this was making it colorful, making it, instant, but also adding a little flair to it with the artwork of just that it ties it all together.
So it shows him in motion.
Yes.
It gives that impression.
Mm-hmm.
So when you do a piece like that, not only is it the printing, then you have to do the distribution, getting that out to 1,000 different places. And I imagine that's what the client does.
The client usually with something like this, depends on the number, does the distribution.
Right.
If it was a mail piece, a lot of times the client does. You can use mailing houses. There's different ways to do it. Every client, depending on their budget, has different needs.
Right. So finally, let's talk. You have an invitation that you brought along. So we'll talk a little bit about how you get somebody sucked into an invitation and how you get them to respond. It's probably one of the most complicated pieces you have to do in terms of there's a lot going on. You expect them to, there you go.
Yes. Basically, this one, you have to think about the components that you need involved. One, they need to be able to respond. They need to have an RSVP. This was for an organization in Baltimore, so they need directions. And you needed an image, you know, that it's the neighborhood design center. They do community rehabilitation, so, you know, that was the idea behind the artwork with it, all pieces of different tools, you know, the tape measure. And, you know, I think with all the charities competing for different things, you need a an invitation that's classy.
Oh yeah,
it has and, to stand out. And look and stands out.
So in the minute or so we have remaining, let's talk a little bit about the future. I mean, industry has progressed dramatically in the last few years. Where do you see things going? You talked about social media and some other ideas.
I think social media still have a big part in it. I think that's a very untapped resource. Companies are starting to learn how to use it. I think print will always still be there. It's just how do you use it effectively.
Right.
You know, email, blast are going to be another component. I think it's how you tie all the new media in with your traditional media and put it together to create a successful campaign that keeps you out there. Newspaper advertising is still extremely important, especially in Berks County. Trust me, people read that paper.
Right.
My wife has had talks advertised in there, and many people have come up. I mean, and that's a way to get free advertising. If you're a new business, just call them up and say, would you like to do an article? I just opened up my coffee shop.
Right. Yeah, it's amazing. You can take advantage of free media.
Extremely, a lot of advantage of that, yes.
That works. Well, Marshall, thank you for being a guest on the program.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me.
Our guest has been Marshall Pickard, who's running Pickard Advertising and Design. I just did it again. Pickard, sorry.
That's okay. It happens a lot.
When you learn something wrong the first time, you remember it that way for life. Sorry.
That's
but anyway, I'm Bob Wirt, Managing Director for Investments of the Wirt Investment Consulting Group of Wells Fargo Advisors. I'd like to thank you for joining us in Berks Business, and we'll see you again second Monday of next month.